Throughout this period, there is a continuous cross-flow of information between Vietnam and the test division at Fort Benning. It is an unusual opportunity for the military. Role extends to providing air crews and advisors in the field. U.S. personnel are supposed to be non-combatant. Under these circumstances, rules of engagement are restrictive, and helicopter crews are not allowed to open fire on the enemy unless they or the escorted transports are fired on first. These restrictions preclude the testing of any offensive tactical concepts at this time. On the 26th of February 1963, the rules are changed. Following from an incident in which two helicopters were shot down and a U.S. serviceman killed, the chopper crews are given sanction to initiate fire against targets identified on the ground. Although they remain in name non-combatant and will continue their job of ferrying South Vietnamese troops, no longer bound to shoot second, the choppers will now begin to adopt an offensive role. By mid-1963, the use of helicopters in Vietnam is widespread, and many elements of the air mobility concept are now in practice. Most of the old twin-rotor Shawnees have been replaced, and the Hueys are operating in a whole variety of roles, each with its own distinctive nickname. As troop transports, they are called slicks, while their escort gunships are referred to simply as guns. Sporting red crosses and in growing demand, the air ambulance versions are known either as medevacs or dust-offs. Showing little regard for the Geneva Convention, some Viet Cong have found that these red crosses made ideal aiming points, and some crews in response have added door guns to their aircraft. During an aerial assault, the helicopters now follow a well-established pattern, with each operation breaking down into two phases: the en route phase and the approach phase. As yet, Viet Cong have little by way of heavy air defenses, and so the en route flights are made at an altitude of about 1,500 feet. This keeps the choppers out of range of small arms fire, but means that they're visible for quite a distance. The flight formation is determined in the main by two factors: the size and shape of the landing zone and the company commander's requirements for disembarkation. The most commonly used formation is the V, which is easy to control and permits the landing of the flight in a short space of time without bunching. A few miles from the objective, the approach phase begins. The helicopters drop down close to ground level to take advantage of terrain masking. Two or four gunships employed for escort and reconnaissance travel a few minutes ahead of the main group to prepare the landing zone. Prepping, as it's called, involves circling the area to draw enemy fire and shooting into the tree line and any other places in which enemy forces may be concealed. Knowing when the machines are most vulnerable, The Viet Cong frequently hold their fire until the last moment when the helicopters flare, committing themselves to land. A cold landing zone can quickly turn hot. So during this stage, the idea is to put as many of the ships as possible down at the one time. The theory being that this minimizes the chances of the enemy concentrating their fire on one helicopter. It also allows the maximum number of troops to unload and return fire. The gunships remain in the area throughout, circling and laying down suppressive fire until the last of the transports have left. The development of the Air Assault Division had brought with it the need for more trained flyers. An estimated 9,000 pilots would be required by the end of the year, and that figure would be increased to 20,000 by 1968. In order to meet this demand, the officer training program is being revised to allow for an increase in the number of warrant officer commissions. The prospect of flying helicopters held great appeal. And at Fort Walters, Texas, the U.S. Army Primary Helicopter School, hundreds of hopefuls had signed up for the warrant officer program. Here the candidates will begin their 9 months of intensive training, with 1 month of pre-flight tuition. Before going near a helicopter, they must first understand the basic principles of how these aircraft work. For the next 4 months, each candidate will be with an instructor pilot, spending several hours each day flying small H-23 and H-53 helicopters. They must use this time well, for once they have mastered the rudiments, things become increasingly complicated. Now the instructors may cut the throttle without warning, forcing the pilots to practice auto-rotation, the emergency procedure for landing after the helicopter has suffered an in-flight power failure. In the future, such a power failure may occur over hostile territory as a result of enemy gunfire. At the end of 4 months, the candidates each get to make their first solo flight. Once they've soloed successfully, they will receive their wings and are ready for the next stage of training. Fort Rucker, Alabama, is the location for the U.S. Army's Advanced Helicopter School. The skills acquired at Fort Walters will now be sharpened as pilots concentrate on the more refined aspects of flying. They practice navigating blind, an essential skill for poor visibility and night operations when all judgments about the helicopter's whereabouts must be made trusting only on readings from the flight instruments. At this point in their training, it is likely that few, if any, of these pilots are aware of the political situation in Vietnam. America itself is undergoing great change, with a growing civil rights movement and the recent assassination of President Kennedy shifting the focus of public attention to domestic matters. Towards the end of their time at Fort Rucker, the pilots get the chance they have waited for. Now, after months of working with the comparatively slow and lumbering trainers, each of them will get to spend 27 hours clocking up flight time on the Huey. The training at Fort Rucker is devised in close consultation with the researchers at Fort Benning and the pilots from Vietnam. And although the maneuvering becomes more realistic day by day, amongst these students there is still little thought of going to war. In August 1964, US warships patrolling in the Gulf of Tonkin are involved in a series of exchanges with vessels from the North Vietnamese Navy. In the wake of these incidents, Congress passes a resolution giving President Johnson the power to take all necessary measures to repel any armed attacks against forces of the United States and to prevent further aggression. In Johnson's words, the bill is like grandma's nightshirt. It covers everything. It also marks the starting point for a massive escalation in US involvement in Vietnam. Acting with this new freedom, the president initiates a campaign of limited, retaliatory strikes against military targets in North Vietnam. As the year progresses, the attacks carried out by carrier and ground-based aircraft become more frequent, and the range of targets broadens to encompass infiltration routes and Viet Cong staging areas north of the border.